Hi everybody, thanks for attending my very late session. Sorry for that. I hope you're not too tired. My name is Tim Messerschmidt and today I'm going to present my talk, Painless Payments for Droids. Basically what I do is I'm going to show you how you can have very nice payments without having the user to enter lots of data into your application. So, as mentioned, I work for PayPal. I'm a developer evangelist, so my responsibility is basically working with startup and developer communities, flying around and making a better world for developers. So, most of you guys at some point want to earn money, right? And earning money for Android is sometimes a bit of a pain. So, who of you has ever tried the Google In-App Billing SDK? Did you like it? So, I've been trying it out as well, because of course I want to see what they do, and it was a bit painful. On the other hand, it mostly works for digital goods, but what do you want to, what's on with personal payments, what do you want to do with physical goods, and this is where we come in. But let's step back for a moment. So there's another big topic, identity. So if I want to go to a store, to your application or something, mostly I've got to enter lots of different data. You ask me for my name, you ask me for my email address, you want to have a password, you store this thing somehow, you go to some credit institute, you want my credit card number. This is things I don't want to give you, mostly. So we have something we call login with PayPal, and login with PayPal is something that's formerly known as PayPal Access. I hope you get it. Any Prince fans here? So basically what this does is, it's our tool, our wonderful tool that enables you to have PayPal users log in with their existing account. So lots of PayPal users have mostly valid data in their account because either they have valid data and they get what they bought, because lots of shops use the PayPal addresses to ship it over there. Or what they do is they enter crap and they don't receive what they buy. So it's a good reason to enter for really good data. So if we talk about identification in the web, mostly we talk about two big buzzwords. There is one, authentication. Basically, authentication means I, Tim Messerschmidt, say, I am Tim Messerschmidt, I want to be the guy who is recognized as Tim Messerschmidt, so I prove my identity. And then there's authorization. That means I, being anonymous, provide you my data, so you can, as an example, have my profile picture, you can access my calendar. Twitter is quite common as a sample, so what you do is you log in with Twitter somehow, somewhere, and they can read your tweets, they can reply to something, they can interact with your data. But what they don't know is, what's your name, what's your password, because they don't need it, they shouldn't have it. So what we use for this is a combination of OAuth2 and OpenID Connect. So OAuth2 is being used in OpenID Connect to provide authentication. And basically what you do is, you have just a few URLs that you call and you use this to log in. So who has ever implemented OAuth1? Did you like it?
No.
See? OAuth2 anybody? It was better, right? Common sense? I guess so. So OAuth2 is way nicer to implement than OAuth1 because OAuth1 was a huge pain. So OAuth1 got designed in the early days of Web 2.0, even Web 1 something. And the big intent was we enable people to use existing accounts to log in somewhere else. But what they didn't know when they designed it, and they is IETF, is basically there's going to be mobile clients, there's going to be embedded systems, lots of different login schemes, and they can't always do the same stuff. So that's when they came in with OAuth1a and finally with OAuth2. But sometimes OAuth2 is not really what you want, because just proving that you can have access to my stuff is not enough. Sometimes I have to pretend it's me. And sometimes having just this very rough scheme is not enough because it's not really defining what do I want to do with my data once I have access? How do I define an API? And that's basically where OpenID Connect jumps in. It uses OAuth2 for authentication. And what you get is you get an API-like way to access resources. You get session management, so you can do a valid logout. Who has ever tried to log out from Twitter with an app? So what you do is it's revoking your existing token. So you remove the application. But sometimes you don't want to remove the whole application. You just want to end your current session. And that's not really possible because you have to delete the whole token. And that's one of the things that OpenID Connect provides you. So there's a very quick flow for this. It's very easy. So we've got an authorization URL. You open it. There is a login page being provided. You enter your data, and there's going to be an authorization token. Your client checks if the authorization token is valid. Then basically what happens is you send it again to the server. The server proves if it's still the existing token, and you get an access token. And that's enough to request resources. So this gives you lots of nice things. You get the valid name. You get the valid address. You get an email address. You know if this guy is a PayPal verified user. That's a bit complex. So verified basically means this guy is really reachable under this email. So if I contact him over there, he's going to answer, hopefully. And that's quite nice. So if somebody logs in with Twitter as an example, you cannot really expect that the data is really valuable because it might not be very correct. For me, it's just Tim from Berlin. That doesn't really help me in my e-commerce. So summarizing identity, we can use login with PayPal to make sure that I have got some data for my users. And what they do is in your application, they just open up a web view, you integrate this, they log in once, you get the data, and you have got this whole profile. But now let's come back to money, or even more money. So when we are talking in apps, we're talking about digital goods and physical goods. For digital goods, there is clear guidelines from Google and Apple, and they say everything that you can basically pay and buy through Google Play, as an example, has to be bought through them. So Google Checkout is what you have to use for digital. So Google takes, I think, 30% margin for this, and that's okay because it works. Users have payment data inserted, it works. But sometimes it's not always digital. So we're coming to physical goods. It might be your pizza app, it might be a coffee app, personal payments, a service. And in this case, I want to accept payments in my app and it shall be a nice experience. So basically there's two different ways to get started. The first way is traditional for us. It's the web. So what you do is you've got just your regular PayPal integration in the internet. We call it Express Checkout, and what you see is you have got some kind of store, he has a PayPal button, you click on it, you get redirected, enter your data, get redirected to the merchant, you say, yes, I want to pay, it executes the payment, and hopefully you get some kind of success page, something that shows you it went through. But if you're talking about native, so Android, we want some other stuff. What we offer is of course a simple payment. So simple payment is one-on-one. So I pay somebody in this room just 10 euros or something, and it's quite simple. But we've got some different other things which are really nice. We've got parallel payments. So I can send money to multiple people, up to six, with different amounts. So somebody gets 10 euros, somebody 20 euros. That's very nice. Now it gets even a bit nicer. We've got a chain payment. So what we can do is, I send somebody 100 bucks, And he sends a part of this to other people. So one guy of these just gets 20 bucks, we have a 30, we have a 10, and the guy in the middle can keep some money. That's a so-called marketplace. And that's very cool if you offer something where people can, as an example, sell their own goods, if you offer a store. This is very neat. And I got the question, if you, as an example, can accept payments for somebody else and take a share. You can do this either with a chain payment or the parallel payment. And basically, if you think about it, it's just one transaction that you do. And at least for me, when I joined PayPal, it was like this. So I think it's very nice. You have this tool set which really enables you to do complex payment situations without really having to do complex code. And I'm going to show you why. So first of all, you need to download the SDK. You have to get your API credentials at x.com. That's our developer homepage right now. Then you can use our sandbox app ID. So basically for testing, you just can begin with this one. It's always the same, so it's not a problem to take this. Add the jar file that we provide you into your own project. And you need to modify your Android manifest. What do you need to do? You add the PayPal activity. I would advise to add the config changes as well, because this basically provides a nice experience. And the translucent theme looks good with it, so that's what we use most of the time. Then what you're going to do is you declare the needed permissions. So there's three. Internet is quite obvious. I want to know if you're connected, so I need the Wi-Fi state as well. And the phone state is being done to get the phone number, because what you can do with the SDK is you can say, once I've logged in, I can take my phone number and assign a PIN to do a faster checkout for the next time. So once I made the changes to my Android manifest, I need to initialize the library. So you take any activity where you include your payments. And what you do is you run a thread, because this runs synchronous, and you want to run it asynchronous to not crash your app. So you provide your app ID and the environment you want to use. So this can be paypal.env.sandbox, or it might be live. There's even an offline environment to check it even if there's no Wi-Fi. And that's just mock data, but still it's quite useful. So you try to get the instance. If it's null, you initialize it, and then you can work with it. So creating the payment is very easy, and just a few lines of code, gladly. So what you can do is you create a PayPal payment. It, of course, needs some kind of recipient, because somebody needs to get the money. You need some amount, because he needs money, and the currency. You can define which payment type it is. It's like digital goods or physical goods, but you don't have to do that. It's an optional parameter to make it nicer for your history and those things, because you get this data later on. Then you create an item, which basically consists of a name. You add the quantity, and you set a price. So I know how many times I need to charge you what. Then I create the invoice, I add my item, I set the invoice in my payment, and that's it. So I've been talking about simple payments being very easy, while parallel payments are becoming more complex. But this doesn't really reflect in the code. So what I do is, instead of having just one receiver, I have the PayPal receivers object, and I just set the same information over there. So I've got an array of receivers, and I've got my payments, which I pass. So basically, I just get the receivers after they were created, I pass them on, and this is it. Our activities know how to handle it. The only difference is that there is PayPal advanced payment instead of PayPal payment, and that's it. Now, when it comes to executing, we thought it might be very wise to go with Android. So what we do is we just let you fire an intent. So what you do is you take your payment, be it a parallel payment, chain payment, simple payment, whatever you want. You create an intent out of it. And what you do is you just start it. So you can either go with start activity, and you can provide some kind of delegate which gets the result. Or what you can do is you can use the start activity for result mechanism. So you have a very clean way to handle your results. So this looks like actually like this. What you do is you get your request code, you check if it's the same one. If it's the same one, it's hopefully my payment. And then I just check, is it the activity result okay thing? So my payment gone through. Is it canceled? So my user dropped off. Or is it result failure? Paper messed up. So coming back to this intent-based thing, to me it's a very big advantage because we didn't hack around in the system and try to make it nice and work without checking what's nice for the system. And it's very clear for Android programmers how to use it. The nice thing is as well, you don't even have to execute your payment immediately. What you can do is you can get a pre-authorization for your payment. So basically, the user agrees that a payment of, let's say, 16 euros can be done, but you don't execute it now. You execute it in 10 days, 2 days, up to 90 days. There is lots of cool stuff that you can basically do with this combination of multiple receivers, pre-authorization. That's very neat, at least for me. So then we've got something else. It's called IPN. IPN basically means, yeah, I've got a nice app, it works, I've got payment, but my backend needs to know about this. So you can use IPN, which is the short term for instant payment notification. You provide your own server URL, and what it does is it just posts against the server, and it enables you to control what happened. So in your app, what you do is you just provide your server URL. PayPal does a post after the payment against your server. Your server can verify with PayPal again. And then you can store this in your database, send it around an email, update your stock items, whatever you want. So I think we've got a few minutes for live code. All right. So what I do is I create a new activity. Oh, sorry. You don't have to see it, believe me. So let me just quickly clone my screen, please. Oh, doesn't really work. Work now. So again, let's try to create an activity. So what I need is the ID. As I mentioned, we have got the sandbox ID. I've got a snippet for this one. So we just add this. Then at some point I need my context of the app. So let's set a variable for this one as well. Then we want to have a PayPal instance, so let's store this as well. Then we need our onCreate method, of course. And we need to set my UI. I want to have a button which basically triggers my payment. I just find the button in my layout, which is kind of very easy. What I'm going to need is a handler to update my UI once my thread is done. And I declare the method that I use to initialize my library. As I said, this needs to be done
in a thread or some async task or whatever you prefer. So I've got my instance object, so I say PayPal get instance, and if the instance is null, I need to initialize it. So the context that I stored, my app ID, and the environment. Let's go with this one. Now I need to store the context because otherwise my app will crash. This is not the nicest way to do the context thing, but it's a hack, okay? And once this is done, I start my thread. And what I do is I post something against my handler. And I enable my button. Because obviously it doesn't make sense to have a button which doesn't do anything until your paper library is initialized. So now I want some kind of method that gets triggered once my button is clicked. And this is where the payment comes in. I create my PayPal payment. I set the recipient. This is MrFoo@bar.com. I set the currency to US dollars and the total amount is sadly a big decimal, which is not too nice, to 20. Now I need to know, basically I've got the payment, it has to be very rough data, but I want to know what I bought. So I need my PayPal item. Oops, I need a name for it. Your item needs to have a name, so let's call it hipster shirt. Your item has of course a price. Let's set it to 20 as well. And what you want is a quantity. Then you need your invoice data, where you add the item in. If I'm too fast or I don't talk enough, just say it. And I add my invoice item in this. And I need to set the data. So let me quickly check what I'm missing. Ah, actually that seems to be quite good. So I need my intent. I get this from my instance and I need to get the intent via the method. So basically I need to look it up. Oh yeah, it's just checkout. It's quite easy and convenient. And I need to provide my context. And what we do is we use the start activity for result mechanism. So I start the checkout intent with the request code 7. You can just use any integer. Yeah, right, sorry. Now I've got the onActivity result method. I don't need the supercaller here. I check if the request code is my request code. And if that's the case, I check the result code. And what I do is I just show a toast which just states yeah or cancelled. Now, since I had a backup activity, what I do is I just rename this to pay activity. You can see my different permissions there that I requested, and you see that you have to declare the PayPal activity because that's what's being called. And to quickly show you my layout, oops, that's the wrong one. I've got my method declared via the onClick mechanism, which uses some reflection to basically make it easier to set onClick listeners. So every time my button gets clicked, the method onPayClick gets automatically called, which I declared here. What we're going to do is we just try it. So this is my wonderful emulator. So you saw that the button was grayed out for a few seconds. Now it's clickable. I click on it and it will crash. No, it doesn't. Yay. So I enter my sandbox details. I hope it was right. It logs now in with the PayPal account. And then you have to confirm that the payment has to go through. That worked. I click on pay. And it worked. So, as you saw, that's quite easy. Of course, I'm in training, but at least you can do that in a few minutes if you want to. And here are the links. Come on. So you can either go to x.com/mobile, or you can go for other stuff like our new REST API documentation to developer.paypal.com, and you will find most of the needed information over there. Furthermore, we're going to do a big hackathon in Berlin on June 8th and 9th. And basically, we invite all of you guys to come over. It will not be only for Android developers. Basically, it's for whatever you prefer. If you want to do hardware, software, or web, we don't care as long as it's a really cool hack. Is there any questions? Sally Nuts. So the question was if it is possible to customize the PayPal activity. We don't provide this mechanism right now because if people come to PayPal, they shall see the same branding over and over again, and that's the like trust factor. So it's branding reason basically.
I asked because you do it at the web interface. I can insert a logo or something like this.
Yeah, so what you can do is you can provide your merchant name over there. So in the web, you can set a logo, your name, and a color. On Android, we don't add the color functionality right now, but you can set your merchant's name at least. But there's going to be a new Android SDK soonish, I hope in the few next weeks. And I've heard this might be a feature in it. More questions, please? No? Everybody satisfied? If not, you can reach out to me, drop me an email. Feedback is always welcome. Thanks for attending, especially this late.
Thank you, Tim.